allowing him to preach your word and let us all be edified and loved. Just ask you in Son of Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right, let's focus in there in Ephesians chapter number 5. And specifically, let's look there in verse number 18. We'll begin reading there. The Bible says, "And be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord." Now, I grew up an independent fundamental Baptist, and while I was growing up, I heard verse 19 quoted very often. And the reason why, you know, we sing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, right? But there's something more significant in this passage, because the actual context there begins in verse 18, where it says, "And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess," and he tells you, "but be filled with the Spirit." Now there's a continuation here of the same thought, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. So he actually gives you the recipe of how to be filled with the Spirit. So that's a very significant passage right here. Then not only that, it shows you the importance of music in the Bible. Now, like I said, you know, I grew up an independent fundamental Baptist. There's obviously differences in the brand that I grew up in and then the church that I now attend. But I grew up an independent fundamental Baptist. And that phrase, independent fundamental Baptist there, that title, when someone says that, "Hey, I'm an independent Baptist," or "I'm a fundamentalist," there's certain things that they usually will stand for. There's certain things that they should stand for if they truly are an independent fundamental Baptist. Number one, they should stand for salvation by grace alone, by faith alone, not of works. Number two, oftentimes these churches are soul-winning churches. Very often they are. Number three, they're King James only. These are things that, being an independent fundamental Baptist, what those churches will stand for if you were to go to it, if you were to look up an independent Baptist church. Now that's starting to change. And there's another thing when I was growing up that's becoming less and less common that every independent fundamental Baptist church practice. Because we say, so what does it mean? Let me say this first. What does it mean when we actually say, you know, we're independent fundamental Baptist? I told you what some of the beliefs are, but what does that phrase mean and why does that define our beliefs? Because being a fundamentalist, what you're saying is, I believe the Bible, the King James Bible specifically, to be my final authority. And it is my final authority in all matters of faith, and not only faith, practice. Now, one major difference in a lot of churches that's taking place, and one of the very first fundamentals of the faith that a lot of the independent Baptist churches are turning from, is when it comes to their music. Now, independent Baptist churches always used to sing hymns. Some would, like Pastor Anderson. I've heard other churches, you know, try to duplicate the Psalms. Obviously it was written in Hebrew, so it's kind of hard sometimes to put the Psalms to music. I've heard that prior to that, but they always sang hymns. And they did that because that is biblical. That's not just a preference. Independent Baptists don't just choose to do that because, oh, that's just the style of music that we like. You know, that's just what our ancestor did. They did that because right here, this is not a suggestion. Read it one more time what it says. Verse 18, one more time, we'll begin there again. "And be not drunk with wine." Now, is that a suggestion when he says, "And be not drunk with wine"? No one would say that's a suggestion. That's just, he's just kind of saying that's probably a good thing in your life. Don't be drunk with wine. "And be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit." So if the first statement about not being drunk with wine is not a suggestion, then neither is the statement about being filled with the Spirit. They're both commandments. And then he tells you the recipe of how to be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Keep your hand here and flip over to the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter number 3. Colossians chapter number 3. And I'm going to preach about the subject of music in light of the Bible. The title of my sermon is Psalms and Hymns and Spiritual Songs. Psalms and Hymns and Spiritual Songs. Now, this is a parallel passage here in Colossians chapter number 3, with Ephesians chapter number 5. And we get a lot more information. That's why when something sticks out in your Bible reading, you notice, hey, I think I remember a very similar statement elsewhere. Or if you're reading in the New Testament, you notice, hey, this is a quotation. It's very, very important to look that quotation up. Because you're always going to learn more about that passage, and there's a doctrine being taught. If there's a doctrine being taught, you're going to learn more about that doctrine. You're going to be able to look at that doctrine from a different angle. God always will word things in different ways, just so we can expand our knowledge on that particular subject. Now look over at Colossians chapter number 3, I want to read verse number 15 for a reason first. So look at verse number 15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. So notice, in this passage, it doesn't mention not being drunk with wine. That was just being used as an illustration. And it doesn't mention the Spirit as well here. But it says in verse 16, the very first phrase which brings us into that, which this is a parallel scripture with what we had just read in Ephesians 5, 19. The first statement is, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So notice in the last passage it talked about in Ephesians chapter number 5, it brought up being filled with the Spirit, right? This phrase actually starts out in the very beginning, this verse. The first phrase is, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. So it used the word Spirit over in the book of Ephesians, and then here it talks about the word, showing that these are being used interchangeable. Now, when you look at this passage, what it reads is, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace and grace in your hearts to the Lord. And a lot of people look at this passage, and they look at that as being three different categories: psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, let's just look at Psalms first, number one. That's something that's very simple. That's something we know very well, right? Psalms is a book of the Bible. There's an entire book of the Bible that was put to music that David spake by the Spirit of God. And that is God's Word, right? That is, you know, we have that book still in our Bible today. The following mention there, the second thing mentioned in that list is hymns. We're very familiar with hymns. The Bible mentions, we'll look at this passage in a minute, but the Bible mentions the disciples singing in hymn, right? We're very familiar with hymns, are we? We just sang hymns just before the service, right? So those two things we're very, very familiar with. Now, a lot of people want to look at this passage, and a lot of independent Baptist churches that are apostatizing, that they want to start conforming their music to the world, they want to look at this passage and they want to say, oh, spiritual songs. That means just other songs that talk about God, just any kind of music. And then they start putting, you know, CCM music in, contemporary Christian music. Yeah. This is a passage that's often used to support that belief. Now here's the thing, just by common sense, I'm well aware of what psalms are and the type of music that it is, the lyrics. I know the type of instruments that are used, right? And then I know what hymns are. They're almost identical in practice. It doesn't matter how you would try to, you know, imitate the psalms being written. We know the music that was used, or we know the instrument that was used to produce the music. There's no possibility how different it could be. It couldn't be an extreme difference between hymns. They're very similar in style. Now, these people expect you to believe that you have psalms and hymns mentioned, which are almost identical, but then you have spiritual songs way over here, which is entirely different. The lyrics are entirely different. The music, as far as the style, is entirely different. 100%. But I'll tell you exactly what this passage is teaching and what spiritual songs are. Now, the context, number one, what did we see in Ephesians chapter 5? It talked about being filled with the Spirit, right? And how were we going to do that? We were going to sing, right? Sing psalms. What is psalms? It's the Word of God, right? If you pick up a hymnal, there isn't a hymn in that book that you can't find the Word of God somewhere in it. I would, and if there is one, then we shouldn't sing it. Because in context, the Bible very plainly commands, the reason why you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs is why? Because we want the Word of Christ to dwell in us richly, right?
Right.
So the reason why we pick out and we choose psalms to sing and hymns to sing is because we want the Word of God to dwell in us. If a hymn doesn't contain the Word of God, then we are singing that song for no reason. Right? Now, so if the context is the Word of God, right? The context over there, the context here in Colossians is the Word of God. The context in Ephesians is spiritual songs. Wouldn't it make sense, or being filled with the Spirit, wouldn't it make sense that the similarity of spiritual songs and the other two would also be the Word of God? There's no possible way, number one, proved by this passage, that spiritual songs could be a song that does not contain the Word of God. That's something that you can guarantee according to this passage. And I'll tell you exactly what this is teaching and what spirit, the word, that phrase, those two words mean, spiritual songs. Psalms is 100% the Word of God. Hymns includes the Word of God. The Bible often, when it will name a list, an example is in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter number 8, where it says, he's speaking of the Old Testament tabernacle and the rituals and the carnal ordinances, and he says, which stood only in meats and in drinks and in divers washings. So those are all three different things, but they have something in common. Now, the very next word is going to summarize what he just said, which stood only in meats and in drinks and in divers washings and in carnal ordinances. So notice how that's just thrown on in the end. That's the way the language of the Bible is. So he gives you three things there, which are aspects of the last one. They're all different angles. They're all different, you know, carnal ordinances. But do you know what they all are? They're all carnal ordinances.
Right.
Psalms are spiritual songs. Why? Because they contain the Word of God. What makes a song spiritual? Jesus Christ said, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." So what is a spiritual song? It's a psalm and a hymn. There is no third category of music that these people try to create. You know why they do it? Because they're apostatizing. And I personally don't recommend for a person, I don't care if they're King James only, I don't care if they have the right gospel, I don't even care if they're going soul winning. If a church has started the CCM music and if they've started that, they've went down that path. I have three examples in my personal life, in the area that I live, of fundamental churches that I was well aware. I knew the pastor well. The man used to be against CCM music. He stood against liberalism. And the very first step that all three of those churches took toward apostasy was letting that worldly, fleshly, carnal music in their church. And you know what happened after that? The church stopped soul winning. The church stopped using the King James Bible. The church stopped preaching the right gospel. They started bringing in, one of the churches at least doesn't even preach the right gospel to this day. And the other churches, they use the King James Bible behind the pulpit, but two out of three of them at least have said behind the pulpit that you can use other versions. There's plenty of examples of people doing that all the time. And you know where it started? This isn't innocent. It started with putting that worldly music in there. Do you know why? Because there's two different types of music overall. There's the music of this world, and then there's spiritual songs. Specifically, you have psalms and hymns. Spiritual songs is not a category of music. It's not a genre of music. It's either psalms or hymns. Now we're going to look at all these passages we're going to look at today. We're going to see the Word of God tied in with music from the very beginning of the Bible and on. We're going to look a lot in the Old Testament. Now, I'm going to have you turn to Acts chapter number 1, verse number 16, because the very first thing that was mentioned of being a spiritual song was the book of Psalms, right? So go to Acts chapter number 1, verse number 16. So why do we sing the Psalms? Because it contains the Word of God. What makes something a spiritual song? The Word of God. You know why this worldly music, you know why CCM music is not spiritual? It's a different spirit, but you know why it's not spiritual according to the Bible? Because it does not contain the Word of God. That's why. Look at Acts chapter number 1, verse number 16. The Bible says, "Men and brethren, this Scripture," Scripture is always a reference to God's Word, "this Scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus." Turn to, look at another passage, Mark chapter 12, verse number 36. Mark chapter number 12, verse number 36. There in Acts chapter number 1, verse number 16, notice what David wrote was considered Scripture. Not only that, it clearly says, "which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake." That is quoting a psalm. That is quoting from the book of Psalms, which is a book of songs. That's what the Psalms are. The Bible, the most quoted book, if you look up the three most, if you ever do a study on it, the three most quoted books in the New Testament are number one, the book of Psalms. Number two, the book of Isaiah. And number three, the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Psalms, which is a book that was that of scripture that was sang. It was a book of songs. It's quoted more than any other book in the New Testament. That shows you, and here's another point about that, another fact about the book of Psalms. It's the second largest book as far as words in the Bible. Isaiah is number one, and then the book of Psalms. Now, depending upon how you look at it, if you break it into chapters and verses, Psalms is the longest book. But either way, you slice it, you know what that means? It's obviously a very important book. And then it's brought up in the New Testament. It's quoted more than any other book in the New Testament. It's the number one quoted book out of the New Testament. So it's not even the largest book in the New Testament, but it also ends up being the most quoted book in the New Testament. Above Isaiah, which has the most words, number two. That's the number two point. And then number three, there are commandments in the New Testament to continue to sing the Psalms. That means you should be reading the book of Psalms very, very regularly, obviously, if you should be singing them as well. Now I had you turn to Mark chapter number 12, correct? Yeah. Mark chapter number 12, another reference to what David wrote was by the mouth of God, was by the Holy Ghost. That means it's the Word of God. That means it's spiritual psalms. For David himself said by the Holy Ghost, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool." So notice the very beginning there, it prefaces it with, "For David himself said, by the Holy Ghost." Like it said before, that the Holy Ghost spake by the mouth of David. Turn to Matthew chapter number 22, verse number 43, for another example. Matthew chapter number 22, verse number 43, it says, "He saith unto them, how then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying," and then he goes on to quote that scripture there. But notice what it says again, David in spirit, referring to the fact that he's writing scripture, right? Spiritual songs. As I quoted before, which is a perfect connection, it just gives a great explanation of that passage, when Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." That's what makes the words spiritual. Turn to 2 Chronicles chapter number 29, verse number 30, because David wasn't the only one that authored the book of Psalms. There was another writer by the name of Asaph. Asaph was another author of some of the Psalms. And here in 2 Chronicles chapter number 29, verse number 30, he's mentioned. 2 Chronicles chapter number 29, verse number 30, the Bible says, "Moreover, Hezekiah the king and the princes commanded the Levites to sing praise unto the Lord with the words of David." Now notice this. They're singing the words of David, and then it says this. And of. So they're also singing words of Asaph. And of Asaph the seer. If you remember the Bible in 1 Samuel, the Bible defines what a seer is. And a seer is a prophet. It's someone that preaches the word of God. So not only in the book of Psalms was David, a lot of people think that David was the only author of the book of Psalms. That's not so. David authored the majority of the book of Psalms. And the Bible's very clear that he spake those words by the mouth of the Holy Spirit spake those by the mouth of David, that the Spirit of God came upon him. But there is a portion in the Psalms that is scripture that actually tells you. Those titles are scripture. That was in, the original manuscripts is translated. It tells you very plainly that Asaph was the author. And here we see that the Bible actually refers to Asaph as a seer. Asaph was a prophet. The words that Asaph wrote were spiritual words. They were not just words of his own. Another passage, turn to 1 Chronicles chapter number 25, verse number 1. We'll see this again. 1 Chronicles chapter number 25, verse number 1. First Chronicles chapter number 25, verse number 1. There's a lot of interesting things actually here. There's another person that authored in the Psalms, and his name is Heman. He wrote, I think, it wasn't very many. He wrote like two. Asaph wrote maybe around 5 or 10, something like that. I can't remember exactly. The Bible says, "Moreover, David and the captains of the host separated to the service of the sons of Asaph and of Heman and of Jeduthun, who should prophesy," notice that, "with harps, with psalteries, and with cymbals. And the number of the workmen according to their service was of the sons of Asaph, and then he goes on to mention the rest of the sons. Now I want you to notice those three people specifically. It says they were separated to the service of the sons of Asaph and of Heman and of Jeduthun. So these three men and their sons, the Bible says right after that, that they should prophesy with harps, with psalteries, and with cymbals. So what they were doing was they were speaking the word of God. They were speaking, they were singing spiritual songs. And what made it a spiritual song? The fact that it was the word of God. Go ahead and turn, have you turn to another passage. 2 Kings chapter number 3, verse number 11. 2 Kings chapter number 3, verse number 11. 2 Kings chapter number 3, verse number 11. So it's not just what was written by David in the book of Psalms was inspired, or just what was written by David in spiritual songs. All of it, all of the book of Psalms is inspired. We believe that the King James Bible is perfect and inerrant from beginning to end. Look at, where'd I have you turn again? 2 Kings, 2 Kings chapter number 3, verse number 11. So over there, you notice that what I want you to notice, the connection repeatedly from the first verse we looked at until the end. It's all talking about songs, and the Word of God is tied in with it repeatedly, showing the importance of the songs that we sing containing the Word of God, number one. In the Old Testament, when the church gathered together, do you know what God had them do? They didn't just make up some song with their own cute words, and they read the Bible and just came up with whatever. God had them speak the word of God while they were singing the songs. When the congregation came together, when they had, you know, all of their feasts, and the Levites were going to play their music and the harps and the psaltery and everything. Do you know what they sang? They didn't just make up a song. They sang the word of God. That's what makes a song a spiritual song. So the songs that we sing, you know, and it's funny because the Independent Baptists don't even understand why they were singing songs and hymns in the first place. The reason why we do it, number one, is because the Bible commands it, period, number one. But God has reasoning behind it. And the reason why all of these churches started singing songs and hymns in the first place is because it contains the Word of God. All those other songs are pointless. They have no power and they have no meaning. The CCM music, you know why? It's crap. The music's crap too, but it's not only because the music's crap, because it's weak, because it's man's words. That's why it's crap. That's why I don't like it. It's because it doesn't have power. Do you know why the songs are awesome? Because it's God's word. Do you know why the hymns are awesome? You know why when you sit here, you just love singing and those songs, just there's something about it that's different than all the music of this world? Because the music of this world is man's words, it's man's wisdom, and the music of that book contains the word of God. In and itself is not, but it quotes the word of God repeatedly. And that's why God says, singing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, he says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. The reason why we sing hymns is not our preference as Independent Baptists. It's because the Bible commands it and because it contains the Word of God.
Amen.
And in the Old Testament, do you know why God had them sing a specific type of music? It wasn't their preference. It's not just David grew up playing this kind of music on the harp. They sang that because God commanded it. Because God said that He wanted them singing the Word of God. He said He wanted them prophesying. Look at 2 Kings chapter number 3, verse number 11. And we'll see, again, the Word of God being tied in with, tied in with music, with songs. So it says, but Jehoshaphat said, is there not here a prophet of the Lord that we may inquire of the Lord by him? So Jehoshaphat shows up here, and he sees that when prophets are brought before him, that they're phony prophets. So he's like, is there anybody else? There's got to be somebody else. And one of the king of Israel's servants answered and said, here is Elisha, the son of Shaphat. He succeeded Elijah. He was Elijah's servant. That's who Elisha was, if you're not familiar with that. Here is Elisha, the son of Shaphat, which poured water on the hands of Elijah. And Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him. Notice what's emphasized about him. Just that simple statement. The word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, and the king of Israel is Ahab, who is a wicked man. That's why he didn't want to bring Elisha. That's why he didn't want to hear Elisha's preaching. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat and the king of Edom went down to him. And Elisha said unto the king of Israel, what have I to do with thee? Get thee to the prophets of thy father and to the prophets of thy mother. This is how real prophets speak. And the king of Israel said unto him, Nay, for the Lord hath called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. And Elisha said, As the Lord of hosts liveth before whom I stand, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat the king of Judah, I would not look toward thee nor see thee, but now bring me a minstrel. And a minstrel is just a person that either sings or plays music. Normally they would do both together. That's what David did. So I'm sure that's what's going on here. And it says, And it came to pass when the minstrel played. So notice the significance in that. He's getting ready to prophesy. He says, Hey, wait a minute. Bring me a minstrel. Right? A person that's going to sing and play music. And it came to pass when the minstrel played, watch this, that the hand of the Lord came upon him. And he said, Thus saith the Lord, make this valley full of dishes, and then ditches, and on and on and on. And he begins to prophesy. So notice what he says before he starts prophesying, before he speaks the word of God. What's the result of the minstrel showing up? What's the result of the music that's come and played? Right? We see God's word over and over again tied in with music. We see a great emphasis on music. We see God's word coupled with music repeatedly. I have you turn to another passage, Matthew chapter number 26, verse number 28. This reminded me when I read this, this always reminds me of when Saul has an evil spirit upon him, right? And they ask for somebody to come that's cunning with the heart. And then David comes, right? Which is a man of God. Which David wrote the Psalms. You know what he played? And oftentimes in the Psalms, and he mentions that even in the Psalms, he played a harp while he's singing. So when he came to Saul, I believe he was singing. You know why I believe that is because that evil spirit left Saul. And not just music itself has power. God's word has power. And I believe those songs that God, that David was singing was the word of God. That it contained the word of God. That he was singing songs unto Saul. And that's what had the power to remove that evil spirit from him. And a lot of people, an evil spirit is just referring to like affliction. And people that are listening to this, saved people that are listening to CCM music that are depressed, you know what they need to do? They need to get some singing songs. They need to get some hymns. They need to start reading their Bible. Maybe that'll get rid of that depression that you have in your life. Maybe that'll get rid of that evil spirit that's upon you. And that affliction. And why you're just so depressed all the time and not happy with life. Right? It talks about the joy of the Lord. Over and over again, you know what David always talks about almost? There are psalms which are geared towards sadness. But in the majority of the psalms, David is very happy. Mm-hmm. Singing God's word makes you happy.
Amen.
This CCM music doesn't do that for you. It makes you sad. It makes me sad to listen to it. Look at Matthew chapter number 26, verse number 28. So we saw, why do we sing the psalms? Number one, because it's commanded in the book of Ephesians, in the book of Colossians, twice in the New Testament. Because it's the Word of God, right? It's a spiritual song. Why do we sing the hymns? Number one, because it's commanded. It's commanded in Ephesians. It's commanded in Colossians. So I told you Matthew 26, 28. Actually, it's Matthew. I think it's 25. I think I have my note wrong here. Let me look.
Matthew 26, 30.
Is it 30? Yeah, it was. I wanted to read that first verse there. 29 first. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Now, I pointed that out first because this is the Last Supper. This is a pivotal moment right here. And then watch what happens when they leave, what they choose to do. Verse 30. And when they had sung an hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Number one, why do we sing songs? Because it's the Bible commands it. Number two, why? Because it contains God's word, because it's a spiritual song. Number one, why do we sing hymns? Because the Bible commands it. It's not a preference. It's not just, I like it, but that's not the only reason why I sing it. It's because it's commanded. Number two, why? Because the Bible teaches that Jesus and his disciples did it, and he is supposed to be an example for us. The Bible, no matter what the shack says, the Bible is very clear that Jesus Christ is our example. Amen. He came to give us an example, the Bible says in 2 Peter. I want you to turn to another passage here. Go to, actually, grab a hymnal. Here, I'll grab one too. I want to demonstrate something of why we sing the hymns. Because like I mentioned before, I said it contains the Word of God, right? I want to give you an example of a song that's just packed full of the Word of God. Go to Psalm number 429. We're not singing it. I'm just going to read it to you. Psalm 429. Hark the herald angels sing. A very popular song. And maybe you sing these songs all the time, and you just don't notice how much of the Word of God is in it. Maybe this will show you that. So verse number 1, we'll begin reading verse number 1 there. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king, peace on earth and mercy mild. So we see Luke 2 being referenced there. And mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Now, verse number 2 here. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Now here we don't have a lot of, we have a lot of references to scripture, phrases. A lot of them, I didn't point a lot of them out. Luke 2 is where most of them are found. Well, the one that I want to really focus on is going to be in verse number 3. But keep reading there in verse number 2. We're going to read all of it. Offspring of a virgin's womb, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. That's like in Colossians chapter number 2. Hail the incarnate deity. 1 Timothy 3:16, of course, that's what it's referencing. Not, like I said, it's not, we don't have plain statements yet or exact phrases. Pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Of course, that's Matthew and quoting the Old Testament. Verse number 3, hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9. Hail the Son of... Now, this is very significant. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Do you see how that's spelled? That's quoting from Malachi 4. And this is almost a direct quote if you keep reading here, where it says, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings. And then it says this, risen with healing in his wings. Since you're in Matthew, turn to Malachi quickly. I want you to look at this. I don't know the exact verse because I didn't look this up, but it's at the very end. Verse number 2. Malachi chapter number 4, verse number 2. So you're there in verse number 2. I'm going to read this one more time to you just so that you remember it. Hail the Son, spelled like solar, sun, yeah, of righteousness, light and love, light and life, to all he brings, and then it says, risen with healing in his wings. Verse number 2, Malachi chapter 4, verse number 2. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son, look how it's spelled, of righteousness arise with healing in his wings. Now you may not notice this, but hymns are like this all the time. They're just packed full of God's word. They're packed full of doctrine. Keep reading there in your hymnal. Risen with healing in his wings, mild he lays his glory by, born that man may more may die. There's many verses that could be a reference to there. And then specifically the book of John. Watch what it says next. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. John 3, of course. Verse number 4. Come, desire of nations, come, fix in us thy humble home. Rise the woman's conquering seed. Genesis 3, 1 Corinthians 15. Bruise in us the serpent's head. Genesis 3, Romans 16. Adam's likeness now efface. That would be Romans 5, 1 Corinthians 15. Stamp thine image in its place. Second Adam from above, 1 Corinthians 15. That's an exact phrase. Reinstate us in thy love. There's probably, I bet if I were to really, I didn't like look at this hardcore. I just remembered Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and I didn't write anything specifically down. I bet I could find just in that one song all the different times that things are re-quoted. I bet I could find over 25 times that quote's somewhere in the Word of God. I guarantee at least over 20 for sure. At least. Because things are quoted multiple times. Do you think the CCM music is like this? You know what makes that song a spiritual song? The fact that it quotes the Word of God. Right. You say to me, that's getting repetitive. Well, then, people haven't understood this for a very long time. Obviously, it needs to be said a few more times. Why? You know, I don't think that these independent Baptists, if they understood that this is a doctrine being taught here, I don't think that they would be forsaking, at least some of them, at least the ones that are just deceived and aren't completely backslidden in their life, I don't think that they would just forsake the old hymns like that. I believe if they understood that God commands it, number one, and that there's a reason behind it. You don't just pick the music you like. We sing God's Word for a reason. We sing hymns for a reason. It's so that we can be Spirit-filled. That's the reason. Go to Second Chronicles. Actually, go to Psalm 150. Psalm 150. This is another very, and these things go hand in hand. Not only are many people just forsaking the traditional hymns, but when they forsake the traditional hymns, they take on an entirely different style of music. So you know what happens? They play different style instruments as well. In order to play, I mean, that's why I mentioned earlier that the hymns and the psalms are very similar. Not only by the fact that they sing the Word of God, but because of the instruments that were used. And we're going to look at that right now. The instruments that are used, when you look at the CCM music, is not the same instruments that we use when we play our hymns. It's not the same style of music either. Look at Psalms chapter number 150. And the Bible actually gives us the instruments that David used. So it says here in verse number 1, "Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in the firmament of His power. Praise Him for His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him with the psaltery and harp." That is not a suggestion. He says, praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Are you telling me it's a suggestion to praise Him? No. But isn't it funny how somebody could say, well, that's just what David did. Yeah. Is it a suggestion to praise Him? No, it's not. And he tells you, in tandem, the way to praise Him is with a trumpet. The way to praise Him is with the psaltery and harp. Excuse me. The way to praise Him with the timbrel and dance. Praise Him with stringed instruments and organs. Praise Him upon the loud cymbals. Praise Him upon the high-sounding cymbals. And then he says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. And there's a lot of churches that have gone, and this is personally a church that I grew up in. They went way too far the opposite direction. They said, hey, we want to make sure that the CCM music doesn't creep in, so you know what we're going to do? We're just not going to use any instruments. That's what my church did that I grew up in my entire life. They weren't against the piano, and they had the piano played occasionally. But they said, let's not use any instruments because we're going to end up... And you know, a deacon literally stood up one day and said, in one of the meetings when this was being discussed, hey, let's start using the piano at every service because we'd use it occasionally, not often. And one of the deacons stood up and said, we're going to end up being like this stinking, I don't know what he named, vineyard down the street if we start using instruments in here. That's total stupidity. Was David like Vineyard down the street? Is David, the type of music that David played, is that like Cornerstone music? It's entirely different. But they still used instruments. So just to say, you know, even though the Bible commands it, even though the Bible says to praise Him on these instruments, I don't want to just because there's a fear of using instruments that somehow we're going to start singing. That doesn't, logically, that doesn't even make sense in any way. I don't know how someone could think that step one would lead you to step two there. That doesn't make any sense at all. But here's the thing. This is what's so stupid about that. You expect me to believe that in the New Testament we're commanded to sing the Psalms, which includes Psalm 150 and many other Psalms where God talks about praising, you know, Him, David, through the mouth of David, praising Him on instruments. We should sing those Psalms and talk about praising Him on those instruments, but we shouldn't use those instruments? That makes zero sense. Makes no sense at all. But I'm going to further show you that these instruments were not just suggestions, and they were not just instruments David liked to use. These specific instruments that are mentioned here are ordained by God in praise later in other passages of the Bible. Go to 2 Chronicles chapter number 29. 2 Chronicles chapter number 29. Now you say, well, do you have to use all of these instruments? Because you guys in Faith the Word don't use cymbals. You guys don't use all these things. Did David use all these instruments every time he played the Psalms? There's multiple mentions where he's using a harp alone. He went and played for Saul, and he still had the Word of God to be able to remove that evil spirit. He still had the power in the song that he was singing to remove that evil spirit with a harp alone. If we don't have these instruments, of course, it's not necessary to use every single one if we don't have the instruments. You know, if a church is, and obviously the church, in the situation of a church that's starting out, you know, there would be nothing wrong with just having a piano. There would be nothing wrong with singing a cappella in the beginning until you purchased the other instruments later, until you found someone that could play those other instruments, until we found someone that played, you know, cymbals, got the right type of cymbals. You know, look at, we'll look at this real quick first. Second, look at 2 Chronicles chapter number 29. We read here a portion of this earlier, but look at verse number 25. It says, "And he set the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals, with psalteries, and with harps." Watch this. "According to the commandment of David and of Gad, the king's seer, and Nathan the prophet." Watch this. "For so was the commandment of the Lord by his prophets." What was the commandment? To use these specific instruments. Do you know why we don't use drums? You know why we don't have a trap set in here? Cymbals are fine. That's not the same as a trap set. You know why? Because the Bible does not tell you to have that. We do not sing the hymns based upon our preference, and we do not... And you say, well, this doesn't look like one of those instruments. This is a stringed instrument. A piano, if you were to open that up, is a stringed instrument. That is mentioned. Stringed instruments are mentioned numerous times in the Bible. Numerous times in Psalms. Elsewhere they're mentioned. Not only in this passage, they're specifically... Now, I think we're getting ready to look at one where they are. The string instruments are mentioned all over the Bible. A harp is a string instrument. It's mentioned right here. We don't choose the hymns based upon preference. We choose the hymns because the Bible commands it. We have a certain style of music that you play and you say it's boring. Yeah, that's because you're stinking worldly. Do you know why? Do you know why these churches, do you know why these pastors are fine with switching over to the CCM? Because they're used to listening to this kind of music already. Do you know why these people that end up wanting to go and they're looking for a church and they come to a church that has the power of God upon it and they're like, man, this is boring. It's because they're carnal. That's why. And then they go over to some church that's playing, you know, the rock music. They go over into some church that's singing the CCM. Do you know why? Because they're fleshly minded. That's the same stinking crap that they were listening to in their lost worldly life. That's why they like it. That's the reason why they like it. You know why? Because they're not filled with the Spirit. If they were filled with the Spirit, they would be singing spiritual songs, hymns, or psalms. There is no other category. There isn't this special category. Another stupid thing. I went to one of those. This is one of the reasons why it makes me so mad. Because I knew a guy real, real well. His name was Jeff Fain, who was in my town, in the Alexandria area, who was a great soul winning powerhouse. The guy stopped soul winning. You know why it started? This stinking music. Brought some guy into his church that was like, went to some liberal church. Maybe the guy was saved. But he went to some liberal church, came into this independent fundamental Baptist church, Emmanuel Baptist, and he convinced or persuaded the pastor to let him start playing his music. You know, start playing the guitar, and he slowly started changing the style of the hymns when he would sing the hymns. I went to revivals there all the time. There was tons of hard preaching at the revivals. People stood up and would just, you know, just rip hard. And this guy, the music slowly started changing. You know what also started changing over time? The preaching. You know what also started changing over time? The soul winning. And that's exactly what happens over time. It starts with the music. It's a big deal. I heard a guy at a revival one time that came there. Some liberal Baptist. Because they started inviting all the liberal Baptists. There was one guy that I came to listen to and my pastor was invited. And me and him both were like, when we got there, I don't sing that CCM, and that's not an area where I go along to get along. If I go and visit one of these churches, I do not sing it. And I haven't for like 7 or 8 years since I've been serving God. My dad, same exact way. If I go to one, some people think, hey, you know, this is one of the areas that 1 Corinthians 9, try not to offend your brother because we want to win them. This is a church of saved people singing this garbage. They don't give me that crap. These people are already saved. That's not what 1 Corinthians 9 is talking about. There was a liberal pastor, preacher, that was before my pastor getting up to preach. And he gets up there and they just got done singing one of these CCM. Everybody's standing. I'm seated. I'm protesting. I'm not a Protestant. I'm seated. My pastor's seated. We don't stand up. This guy gets up and I'm sure he's talking about us because we're sitting in the front row. And the guy's like, hey, now I know some people don't like these new songs, but the Bible talks about we're going to sing a new song in heaven. I have a feeling that's a different style. You stinking liar. David in the book of Psalms said, I'm going to sing to you a new song. It's not talking about Old Testament, New Testament. You're a liar. You just want to try to justify your stinking garbage. You're just not interested in singing spiritual songs. That's why. You know what else that tells me? These retards are not reading the Bible on their own, or they'd be interested in, I know I like the hymns because I read the Bible every day. That's why. That's why I like singing the hymns, because I love God's Word. You know why they don't? Because they're not filled with the Spirit. Because they don't like spiritual songs. You know what they like? fleshly songs. They like listening to the drum beat. That's what they like. They like listening to this carnal music. That's why. And the first step, don't go to a church with this CCM crap. The very first step to apostatizing is forsaking the godly hymns. That's the first step. The songs of the faith. That's the very first step. We read 2 Chronicles chapter 29. Go to 2 Chronicles chapter 23. Second Chronicles chapter 23. I believe this is the right passage. Look at verse number 18. And also Jehoiada appointed the offices of the house of the Lord by the hand of the priests, the Levites, whom David had distributed in the house of the Lord to offer the burnt offerings of the Lord, as it is written in the law of Moses, with rejoicing and with singing, as it was ordained by David. Oh, I know what I wanted to point out about this passage. So, notice that this is taking place years later. But you know what they were still doing? It wasn't just something for David's time. It wasn't just something that was good. These instruments were ordained by God. He chose these specific instruments. God wants us using these instruments. Don't use your own wisdom. Just you go with God's wisdom. Just sing the hymns. Sing the songs. See, if these independent Baptists that didn't understand, hey, there's a reason why we sing it. If they would have just said, let's just do what the Bible says. I don't know why, but let's just sing the songs and the hymns. They would have saved themselves a lot of sorrow today. They would have saved themselves a lot of rewards that they probably lost. And a lot of people that left their church who wanted to sing the songs, who wanted to sing the hymns. They would have built them, they would have edified themselves by singing the spiritual songs, singing God's words, whether they knew that they were, that's why God ordained it or not. That should be the first reason. Why do we sing the psalms? Why do we sing the hymns? Because God commands it, number one. What's the second reason? Because they're spiritual songs. What makes it a spiritual song? God's word. That's why. Do you know why also that we use the instruments we use? God's word. That is our final authority in all matters of faith and practice. Go to, we'll blow through the rest of these. Go to 1 Chronicles chapter number 13, verse number 18. 1 Chronicles chapter number 13, verse number 18. I'll read to you from 1 Chronicles chapter number 15, verse number 28. Thus all Israel brought up the ark of the covenant of the Lord with shouting and with sound of cornet and with trumpets and with cymbals, making a noise with psalteries and harps. Notice over and over again these are being used. These are all different times throughout the history of the kings. You're in 1 Chronicles chapter number 13, verse number 8. It says, and David and all Israel played before God with all their might, and with singing, and with harps, and with psalteries, and with timbrels, and with cymbals, and with trumpets. Turn to 2 Chronicles chapter number 5, verse number 12. 2 Chronicles chapter number 5, verse number 12. I'll read to you from 2 Chronicles chapter number 20, verse number 28. And they came to Jerusalem with psalteries and harps and trumpets unto the house of the Lord. House of the Lord. You know where the house of the Lord is today? It's where the church gathers. The church is the congregation. God does not change. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What instruments He ordained and wanted us to praise Him on in the Old Testament, that's what He wants us to praise Him on in the New Testament, in the house of the Lord, when the congregation is gathered together. I had you turn to 2 Chronicles 5:12, correct? Also the Levites, which were the singers, all of them, of Asaph, of Heman, of Jeduthun, with their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests, sounding with trumpets. Go to Nehemiah chapter number 12, verse number 42. So we saw the instruments being mentioned repeatedly. And the sons of Asaph and Heman and Jeduthun, you know what tribe they're of? The Levites. Do you know what another responsibility of a different section of the Levites was? Was to teach the Word of God. I don't think that that's a coincidence. Why do we sing loud when we sing the hymns? You look at CCM music, oh, you say it's spiritual music. Okay, why does God's Word command to sing loud, but this music claims to be CCM music, the CCM music claims to be God's Word, and they don't sing loud? Right. Look at Nehemiah chapter number 12, verse number 42. Nehemiah chapter number 12, verse number 42. And Maaseiah and Shemaiah and Eleazar and Uzziah and Jehohanan and Melchijah and Elam and Ezer, and the singers sang loud with Jezreiah, their overseer. Turn to 2 Chronicles chapter number 20, verse number 9. Why do we sing loud? Because it's biblical. That's why. 2 Chronicles chapter number 20, verse number 9. 2 Chronicles chapter number 20, verse number 9. If when evil cometh upon us, this is not the right passage. Maybe it's 1 Chronicles. Turn to 1 Chronicles chapter number 20, verse number 9. 1 Chronicles chapter number 20, verse number 9.
It's not there.
Not there. Okay, we'll skip it. Go to Luke chapter 19, verse number 37. Luke chapter 19, verse number 37. This one's right. Luke chapter number 19, verse number 37. And when he was come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples, hear that, the whole multitude of the disciples. So we saw an Old Testament passage, here's a New Testament one. The whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. You know why people will just sing with loud voices? There's commandments in the Bible as well. We're going to look at one in Psalms. But you know why people just sang with loud voices oftentimes just in situations like this? Because they had zeal. That's why you should sing loud. I get excited when I'm singing the hymns. I don't know about you. And it's not just this carnal excitement. I like the words because I like the Word of God. When I start singing about the resurrection, when I start singing about how great God is and how He's going to destroy our enemies and all of that, and other people may not like that, I like that. That's what the Bible teaches. I get excited about that stuff. I get excited about the millennial reign. I get excited about when it's talking about the second Adam. He's going to stamp the image in His place. I get excited about that stuff. You know why? Because I love the Word of God. I want to be filled with the Spirit. I don't want to sing this CCM music because it doesn't contain the Word of God. Why don't you like that music? I don't have to tell you why I think it sounds like garbage and those guys look like a bunch of fags. That has nothing to do with it. You know why? It doesn't contain the Word of God. That's why. End of story. What do you mean? It doesn't contain the Word of God. I have no other reason. Period. The Bible says to sing God's Word. Why don't you like that music? It doesn't contain the Word of God. That's the only answer, period. That's enough. The Bible commands to sing spiritual songs. That's not spiritual. According to the Bible's definition, people change the word spiritual. It just makes me feel spiritual. That's not what that means. You have no idea what the word spiritual means. They want to say they're a Christian and base things and claim to believe the Bible, then they just define words however they want. It makes me feel spiritual. What do you mean? Because it made you feel happy? That's not spiritual. That's not what that means. Go to 2nd. Did I have you turn to 2nd Chronicles yet? No, let's go to 2nd Chronicles 30, verse 12. You know what? Skip that. Turn to Psalm chapter 33, verse 3. Psalms chapter 33, verse 3. Because this goes into the style of music. Psalms chapter 33, verse 3. The Bible says, sing unto him a new song. That's that passage I was actually quoting from before, where David actually says it's a new song. A new song just means it's a new song that he wrote, right? But you know what it still contained? God's Word. That's not the problem with this. You know what? I wouldn't mind if somebody wrote a new hymn, and it was the same style music with the same instruments, which would make it the same style, and it contained God's Word. There's no problem with that. I'm not talking about a new song. I'm talking about a new style. That's the problem. I'm talking about new, different words. I'm talking about different style lyrics. And they want to try to be deceitful and use God's Word to justify that. That's not what that means when that says sing a new song. That means it's just a song that was not written before. It's a new song that he wrote, even in the Old Testament. He's trying to say, it's like this new style that came about. You think David played one song in one style and then he's going to play it in a new style? It's foolish. When you look at people's arguments about stuff like this, when they just grasp for a verse, they always fall apart like that. And another thing about the book of Psalms just popped in my mind. The book of Psalms is a great way to prove doctrine when it's being taught in the Old Testament. There's a verse that, and there's certain things that are discussed more in the Old Testament, and people are like, well, is it repeated in the New Testament? Well, if it's not repeated in the New Testament, then it's not valid. That's faulty logic, number one. The Bible says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine.
Amen.
Period. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But besides that, we have the book of Psalms. Let's say I quote the book of Psalms. Do not I hate them, O Lord, that hate thee. That's Old Testament. Yeah, but I'm commanded to sing the book of Psalms in the New Testament. Yeah. That's why the book of Psalms is so great, because you have the commandment to sing the book of Psalms. You have the reference. It's the most quoted book in the Old Testament, from the Old Testament, the book of Psalms. And it's packed full of all doctrine. Do you know why? Because his songs contain doctrine, just like the hymns. They're exact style music. It's not one category of psalms and hymns over here, spiritual songs. It's psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. These are, psalms and hymns are spiritual songs because they contain the Word of God. And it's, and there's not specific doctrine, you know, that was dedicated to the Old Testament, and then specific doctrine that's dedicated to the New Testament. All, you know, people just do that because they just don't like what you're saying. You know, they just don't like some of the laws of the Old Testament. They don't like God's law. That's basically what it is.
Yeah.
If they would have lived in the Old Testament, they would have had the same opinion. Turn to, so you're in Psalm chapter 33, verse number 3, right? Sing unto him a new song, play skillfully with a loud noise. Notice, the music is supposed to be loud as well. The music should be loud. We should sing loud, and we should play loud. You know, and here's the thing. The reason why these people like this worldly music is because they're worldly, point blank. The reason why, here's the thing, it defines it for you. What is a spiritual song? Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Why do we sing psalms? Why do we sing hymns? Because it's the Word of God. Because God said, let the Word of God dwell in you richly, right? And then he said, speaking to yourselves. So he says, singing in one passage, speaking in the other. In psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Making melody in your hearts to the Lord. God ordained this music for a reason. And whether you understand it or not, that's why you need to keep God's commandments, whether you get it right away or not. It would, like I said, these other churches, it could have saved them a lot if they would have just been obedient to God's word anyways, even when you don't understand it. But spiritual songs is not a new category. Spiritual songs are referring to God's word. And you say, hey, in my life, I want to be spiritual, man. I want to be, you know, I want to be spiritual, right? Like these CCM people. Do you want to know how you can be spiritual? Read God's Word, right?
Yep.
That's where spirit, God's Spirit is. God's Spirit came upon these men and spoke those words. Those words penned down contain God's Spirit. Do you know what else contains God's Spirit? The book of Psalms. David, by the mouth of David, God spake those words. Do you know what else? Those hymns. Those were not inspired, but you know what they did? They took God's word and they put those words in there so that they could sing God's word. Because they wanted to have God's word in their mouth. If you want to be spiritual in your life, Christian, do you know how to do that? Sing daily psalms and hymns. You know what else you need to do? Read your Bible. That's how you are filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. How? Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs. Right? Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father God, we thank you, dear Lord, for your word and how powerful and amazing that it is, dear Lord. We ask that you bless the rest of the day, that you would give us zeal while we sing the songs, dear Lord, that we would be excited while we sing them, Father, that you would help us to be filled with the Spirit, to have the love for the psalms, the love for the hymns, love for your word, dear God. And just be with us today, as I said, bless the services to come, and we love you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.